Men, we were not made to live like most men. We were made to fight. We were made to strive. We were made to work. We were made to conquer. We were made to give ourselves for something that is eternal. Adam was given the command to do what? To go out and subdue. To bring everything in creation in harmony with the will of God. To do all his governing, all his things within the context of God's will. Now we live in a fallen world that lives in darkness and death. The kingdom of the evil one spread abroad throughout the land. You and I were not called to play video games. We were not called to sit in front of a television set. We were not called to give ourselves to trifles. We were called to advance a kingdom. To live with a passion, to fight for him. And to only every once in a while drop our swords and look up for a smile. I want to fight. I don't want comfort. I don't want ease in Zion. Because the kingdom of God is built not by those who rest easily in Zion, but by those who go out into the streets and fight. And the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are mighty. Intercessory prayer, the proclamation of the gospel, and sacrificial love. Men, rise up, O men of God. Do what you were called to do. Be valiant and strong. And know that it's going to cost you. You take your stand beside Jesus Christ in his cause and you watch the devil come after you, buffeting you from the outside and from the inside. But that's what war is about. And so he has given us a great commission to pace a room at night saying, there is a place where he is not worshipped, where he is not worshipped. There is a place where he is not worshipped. I cannot sleep. There is a place where he is not worshipped. There is a place where the flag of Zion does not fly. That's what we were made for. To set aside our little temporal causes and to give ourselves to this one great battle.
I'm going to have to talk real fast. We've got a lot to cover. Welcome to Shock Radio, ladies and gentlemen. On the show today, I want to give a special thank you to Blog Talk Radio channel Raiders News Network. You guys, I was in chat in one of their shows recently, and we were discussing how to survive a nuclear holocaust. We were talking about what we can do to be prepared. And it was an excellent source of information on their show. I've been gathering information from all different places, different avenues. And I contacted Raiders News Network, and I told them, hey, you know, I'm a Christian, and I would like to use some of your information on my show. And I didn't hear anything for like 2 or 3 days, and I received a very kind email back saying, you know what, go ahead. In these times, we all need to stick together. So I want to thank Raiders News Network if you're listening, and I appreciate that. Also, I want to thank you guys, to over 200,000 of you that have subscribed to our free videos at shockforever.com. Also, if you consider yourself a very bold Christian and you believe 100% of the Bible is the inspired word of God, you'll want to join our team at allianceofchrist.com. That's allianceofchrist.com. And also, I want to give a shout-out to my friend Saunders. He is a Christian on YouTube. He does videos, the Anti-Christians Attacked Us channel, and brought it completely down. Show him some love, people. If you could help my friend Saunders when this radio show is over, go to his video channel at youtube.com/ Mr. Romans 9. That's MRROMAN as in Nancy, S, and then the number 9. Saunders does some really good videos. What he does is goes up to people street preaching, and he actually has the video recorder as he's talking to them. So it's great. So check out Mr. Romans 9 on YouTube. Now let's get into what is in the news today, and we'll talk about how you guys can survive a nuclear holocaust, what supplies you'll need. And, you know, we're all watching, I know I am, what if Israel strikes Iran? And there's about 6 different scenarios that could happen. Number one, Iran will close the strait, you know, where the there's a strait where they ship oil. And a lot of people believe that that option is neither feasible nor advisable for Iran, because the U.S. would quickly overwhelm any effort to close the strait. And also Iran would be risking U.S. attacks on its land-based military. And number two, the second thing that could happen if Israel strikes Iran, Iran cuts its own oil exports to raise world prices. An Iranian embargo of its own oil exports would actually completely be the ruin of Iran's domestic economy, because it would deprive the country of hard currency. The third option that Iran could do is they attack U.S. forces in Iraq and Afghanistan. There's some Tehran hardliners that advocate this approach, but that would not be a good approach for Iran either, because doing so would risk direct U.S. retaliation against Iran, as many United States commanders in Iraq earlier recommended. There's a fourth option. Iran increases support for global terrorism. This Iranian option, especially stepping up worldwide attacks against U.S. targets, is always open, assuming, however, that Obama does not further degrade our intelligence capabilities and that our watchfulness remains high. The terrorism option outside of the Middle East is also extremely risky for Iran, because if Washington uncovers evidence of direct or indirect Iranian terrorist activities in America, even the Obama administration would have to consider direct retaliation inside Iran. So there's really only 2 more options. Number 5, Iran launches missile attacks on Israel. Now, because all the foregoing options risk more direct U.S. involvement, Tehran will most likely decide to retaliate against the actual attacker, Israel, using its missiles and perhaps Air Force capabilities. The 6th option, Iran unleashes Hamas and Hezbollah against Israel. By process of elimination, but also because of strategic logic, Iran's most likely option is retaliating through Hamas and Hezbollah. Increased terrorist attacks inside Israel, military incursions by Hezbollah across the Blue Line, and most significantly, as we've seen before, salvos of missiles from both Lebanon and the Gaza Strip are all possibilities. Now, guys, I've been doing some research. You know how many atomic bombs are in the world today? Someone take a guess. They recently did a study, and they found that there's about 70,000 nuclear bombs in the world. So the chances of something going awry is pretty high. Do you guys hear in the news when Netanyahu went and he visited the Kremlin and he talked to Putin? You want to know what he was doing there? You notice how it wasn't really in the news. Like, well, what are they talking about? Get this. Israel names Russians believed to be helping Iran build up their nuclear bomb. The Russians, you guys, are helping Iran build up their nuclear capability. So it's good to be prepared. It's good to know what to do in case of a nuclear attack. And a lot of people believe that, no, if we have a nuclear attack, it's just, you know, there's nothing you can do. Well, if you're a distance away from the nuclear attack, there are things you can do to survive. So what I would suggest is have a pen and a pad of paper ready, or when this show is over, if you miss anything as you're writing down different tips, different supplies you can get, download this show for free in MP3 format. So let's start the show. Let's talk about some information on how you can survive a nuclear holocaust.
All right. Well, let's get right into it, because the theme of tonight's show is surviving nuclear Armageddon. The big question is what to do if a nuclear disaster occurs. What can people do? And let's kind of go down a list. In other words, let's talk about a series of things, whether they should stay at home or not. What are the things they should first do, second do? Let's talk about food and supplies. Let's talk about water. Let's talk about shelter. Let's just go down through the basics, because these are the kind of things that would help people. Can we do it that way?
Sure. No, that'd be great. And right top of the list is make sure everyone in your household knows, especially your kids. You see a bright flash, you hit the deck and duck and cover. You know, wherever you are, and go ahead and stay down there for 20 or 30 seconds. I mean, just, you know, count it out and stay down there. And if there's going to be any blast wave, it will have arrived by then. And if you're close enough that you experience the blast wave when you come out, if you want to move away from where the blast was, obviously. But as soon as you can see a mushroom cloud and you can see how the wind is shearing it, or you can feel which way the wind is blowing, you know, from the trees and everything, if you get an indication of which way it's blowing, you don't want to be going directly downwind away from it. You want to be moving perpendicular. You want to be moving left or right, not directly downwind from it, okay? And this is interesting, 40 miles downwind from like a 10-kiloton suitcase nuke-type bomb, if the wind is steady, 40 miles downwind, that fallout, that plume that's being deposited on the ground as it blows downwind, 40 miles downwind is only 4 miles wide. If you are right in the middle of it and the wind's blowing 10 miles an hour, you'd have four hours to go ahead and just move 2 miles to the left or the right of it. You'd be gone before it got there. End of crisis.
Well, Shane, you know, and this is such an irony, because part of this, I think, is just good practical information, and as opposed to, there's almost kind of a mocking type thing in a lot of media. You know, you're talking about the old duck and cover. I was in school when we were taught to duck and cover, and then we went through this whole period of time where people actually make fun of that. Yeah, duck, cover, bend over and kiss your butt goodbye, because it's not going to do you a bit of good if there's a nuclear explosion. What you're saying is absolutely not true. I mean, if you're in the epicenter, obviously you're going to be incinerated, but not very far from where a nuclear device could be extinguished. Ducking and covering might make the difference between life and death.
Absolutely. And we're talking about, if the population was evenly distributed, that blast wave that could kill you, we're talking about many times more people are in that area than were in the epicenter that are no longer here. So we're talking about saving many times more people just by educating them to not run to the nearest window to see what the bright flash was, just in time to be shredded by the glass blowing inward. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so many victims that we're going to have needlessly. You're going to perish needlessly for lack of knowledge. And, you know, we've explained this sufficiently enough to all of your listeners tonight. They get it. I mean, they got it. And that's how easy this information could be gotten across, you know, to every school, every business. I mean, this, with our mass media today, if the government chose to, everybody could know this. And we could have 90% fewer casualties from a nuclear blast and the resulting fallout just in what we've talked about in the last 45 minutes.
Now, you mentioned,
this is a shame.
But we're here to do something about it, so thank you for being on the show. You mentioned moving laterally, as opposed to moving downwind. You want to shear the wind, basically.
Let's say you're right. Let's say you know, because of the way the wind's blowing, that you saw this big flash and you see this mushroom cloud 40 miles away, and you know the way the wind's blowing, it's, oh man, this is coming straight towards us. The wind's going to blow it straight towards us. Well, you don't want to run directly away from it. Obviously, you don't run towards it, but you don't want to run directly away from it. You want to run to the left or to the right, okay? In other words, be moving away from it, but go to the left or the right, so that if it catches up to you, you know, before you, you know, you're going to be out from under it before it gets to where you were.
That makes a great deal of sense.
And it's, and now, you know.
Now, we sell a video, or I should say Survivor Mall has a video over there called Sheltering in Place. A nuclear event happens. Are there general rule, everybody should leave town, or general rule, you should shelter in place? I mean, how can people listening to this show determine that in their event, it would be wiser to stay where they are or to head out?
Well, if everybody took my advice, we'd have some serious gridlock in our major cities. But if anything nuclear happens anywhere in the world, I don't mean right here, but I mean if, you know, if in Iran or with Russia, if anything nuclear happens anywhere in the world, everybody listening to us tonight, if they live in a major metropolitan area, they need to skedaddle promptly. That you do not want to wait for the government to tell you to evacuate, because it's not going to happen. They're not going to allow that panic and gridlock to happen and shutting everything down. So if you're in a major metropolitan area or close to a military target, if the first instance of anything nuclear going on anywhere in the world, I hope you've been sending Christmas cards to that uncle out in the country, because that's where you're going. And you need to scoot right then. And if you haven't, if things transpire too quickly, And if there's any doubt in your mind that you can't make that trip because the roads are already clogging up and you're going to get stuck in a Houston-type exodus from Hurricane Rita, you know, where everybody was stuck on the highway, if it's starting to look like you can't make the whole trip in time, don't try it. Stay where you are. Make the best of it where you are. You know, just hope you're not right at the epicenter. And you need to shelter in place right there. You do not want to get stuck halfway through on an exodus that stalls out, because then whatever supplies you've got are only going to be what you can carry on foot, and you've got no shelter, and you're amongst a whole bunch of scared, panicked people, and there's not going to be police to protect you, and you don't want to do that. So you evacuate if you've got a place to go, the means to get there, and the time as best as you can figure to beat the rush. But don't wait for the government to tell you what to do, because they're either going to be late in telling you, or they won't tell you with sufficient urgency to get you to do it, or they won't tell you at all.
Shane, it's Joe again. On that note, some people will have the ability to select properties. A lot of people right now are moving across the states for various reasons. Some people are leaving places like Anaheim, California. Some people are moving from Florida, and they're going to not smaller states, but areas where there's a lot less population, with the hopes of finding land. And they're going there with the plans of building things like fallout shelters. Some people, however, are feel that they're stuck where they're at due to work, things like that. What would you say? You know, people without basements, people that maybe live right in New York City or in a place like Los Angeles, what can you tell them about being able to shelter in a place where maybe they live in a studio apartment or a small place that has no basement, they have no access to anything other than maybe just a closet? What are some of the things that they would want to have on hand, or things at their house that they could use to shelter in place?
Yeah. We've had some people call us up, over the last decade, and they tell me about where they are in a big city, and they're convinced that that's probably going to be a target, but, you know, their kids go to school, they got this great job and stuff, and I say to them, the school and the job won't be there if this really happens. I mean, these things that you're saying that appeal to you there, I said, if you really feel that the threat is of sufficient probability that we're having this conversation, move. You know, I can't sugarcoat it. Now, you might be lucky enough to be like in a high-rise building that didn't sustain blast damage. The windows are intact. You know, let's say it happened in the adjoining Twin City or whatever, and all you've got is fallout to worry about. Listen, if you're in a 6 or 8 story or higher building and you can get into the middle of the center of the building, and the windows are intact, that's a wonderful place to sit out the radioactive fallout. And the reason is the fallout is way on the ground level, and it's on the roof. And that distance from you and those multiple floors, all of that shielding, that's a very safe place to be in the center of any structure that's intact. Now, it's not going to work if the windows are blown in, because now the fallout's blowing in on your floor right there. And this is another piece of good news, too. The radioactive fallout is only lethally dangerous for the first 2 to 3 days, okay? Unless you're right on the cusp of, you know, a big crater or something, okay? But the majority of people will be downwind, some miles downwind or 100 miles downwind, and here comes the radioactive fallout, and we'll talk about the shelter they can do in their house, but the first thing they need to know is this radioactive fallout is dangerous because it's giving off so much energy. But because of that, it's getting weaker very quickly. In the first 7 hours, compared to the first hour when the bomb went off, in the first 7 hours, the radioactivity, the lethality of this radioactive fallout has lost 90% of its intensity in the first 7 hours.
Hmm.
And in another sevenfold increase in time, 7 times 7, 48 hours, 2 days, it will have lost 99% of its lethal intensity. So what we're talking about here is if it would have been fatal, you know, at 500 Rentkin per hour, you know, which would be fatal in an hour, what we're talking about is, you know, it's only 1/100th of that in 2 days. So the shelters that we'll talk about next and what you can do at home is cramped and uncomfortable and as expedient and thrown together as they are, you can put up with anything for 2 or 3 days while the worst of the radioactivity dissipates. But if you aren't protected for those first 2 days, you're, mm-hmm. you know, and we have intensity of 500 Rentkin or higher, you're history. You're going through cancer treatments without any painkillers, you know, as you die over the next 2 weeks. And it's this is avoidable. If you couldn't get out from under it before it arrived, and that may be the case, because if you have multiple nukes go off, you've got fallout from one showing up, and then the wind blows one from another, you know what I mean? We could have some fallout to deal with from, it may not just be one event, you know, where you missed it. So if you have to shelter, we're really only talking about hunkering down for 2-3 days, and I don't care how cramped and uncomfortable that is, it's preferable to the alternative.
Yeah. Now, Shane, do you have or do you know if people can find, like, online maps that show how wind or weather patterns, natural patterns, would create better or worse areas in the nation where people can live? In other words, excuse me, if an event like this occurred where the natural weather patterns might tend to channel this fallout in some areas might be worse than others?
Yeah, this information is readily available. I mean, everybody with just a little bit of looking around, they can see which way the wind normally blows in the summer and the winter where they are. But I do have to say at the beginning, the wind can blow in any direction on any given day. So, I mean, we're just picking on an average, you know, the wind down here usually comes out of the south in the summer and the north in the winter. You know, I mean, it's pretty basic. And what we look at is the cities, the major cities, the target type cities that are south of us and north of us. And that's what everybody has to do wherever they are. Which way does the wind normally blow in the summer and winter? And what do I have within 100 miles, you know, upwind of me?
Mm-hmm. I would want to recommend to people, we obviously had reasons behind selling all of our real estate on the West Coast and moving to the Midwest. And I'm not an alarmist. I just had the ability to do it. And I would recommend to anybody that can that they might try to determine if there's a better, safer place they might be. I mean, I'm listening to the experts saying that it's an even chance, 50-50 chance, that within the next 5 years, and you're saying, boy, you hope that it's that long because it could be within the next 5 months, and then I'm listening to an ex-terrorist who accurately predicted what happened to 9-1-1, saying it could actually happen within the next 2 weeks.
I'm surprised it hasn't happened already. I really am with whom we sell products to and the urgency that they've wanted them at different times. I'm really surprised nothing's happened yet. So just by the grace of God, we've all got some extra days to do what we need to do.
Well, by the grace of God, and also as much of a critic of the government as I can sometimes be, I would also want to give credit where credit is due, and I do think that we have had a couple of situations the public isn't even aware of where our intelligence was able to interdict plans, and they were able to stop those plans. Now, how long they'll be able to do that, and they're not going to be able to do it every time, which 9-1-1 illustrated. You know, there are a lot of people in the world that hate America, and they hate Americans, and they want to create as much chaos here as they can. Now, you said earlier that because time is of the essence, people need to, they ought to have a plan in place. And in your chapter in that book, How to Overcome the Most Frightening Issues You Will Face This Century, you talk about how people need to first delegate and assign to different adult family members specific tasks, ought to have a plan in place, and so that in the case of an emergency, this stuff could all be accomplished within a relatively short period of time, instead of being freaked out and panicked and running around with our, you know, hands in the air screaming, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? People have a plan in place, they know what they're going to do, and they've got their priorities in place, which assures them that their family has a better chance of survival. Part of that has to do with shelter, part of it has to do with water, part of it has to do with food supplies. And so that while you have one family member that might be working on water storage or whatever, you have another who's focused on shelter, somebody else that has acquired as much as they can, the right kind of foods and supplies. Now, let's talk about each one of these step by step. Foods and supplies, what are the most important foods and supplies?
Well, first off, the subheading to that topic was what to do if a nuclear disaster is imminent. And we were making an assumption there that most people would not be reading it or pulling it off of your website or mine until something had already happened someplace. So we're making the assumption that they don't have time to order stuff from us or anybody else or from mm-hmm. survivalmall.com, et cetera. So what are they going to do? A nuke has gone off overseas. We've got saber rattling between the U.S. and Russia over it, and something could happen at any time. Or a nuke went off in one of the cities in the U.S. And, you know, it wasn't your city, but it went off, and you're expecting more of it. This is what we're talking about in what you can still do locally. And the first decision is evacuate or shelter in place. And again, if you can do it, go ahead and evacuate if you're in an area that you feel would be a target. But again, only if you know with very high confidence that you can make it the whole way. Most people will be better served to just stay where they are. Okay, so if you're going to stay where you are, as you said, you go ahead, and it's all in that chapter, you go ahead and delegate to the adult members what to do. And with the food list, we're assuming we don't have time to buy MREs and buckets of rice and beans and dehydrated and freeze-dried food and have them shipped in by UPS in 5 days. So we're saying, right, here's what you can buy at the store. And we're sending people off to buy stuff that won't take any preparation for them to eat in the shelter, for the 2-3 days they're hunkered down there. And then afterwards, when they can get out, then we're talking about foods that might take a little bit of preparation. So the first thing on the list is what they'd need in the shelter. And we give them a long list of things that normally are available locally. And then the other members that stay at the house, they need to start collecting water. Water's more important than food. And we're talking about a time where the water supply could be shut off, the sewage might not be working. There could be all kinds of problems there. And if we have people getting ill because of unsanitary conditions, whether it's bathroom excursions and fixing food and stuff like this, we can't count on prompt medical reinforcements at that time, you know? So we don't want people getting sick. You cannot store too much fresh water. So that's what the people are doing that are still at home while the other adults, they've gone by the bank or ATM if they can do it quick to get cash, but they go to the store and try to use their credit card if they can, if they're still accepting credit cards, so they can preserve their cash. And they're coming home with what they can. This is assuming the stores haven't been cleared out, like in a hurricane or something. You know, that there's still there's still food to be had there. What we do too is we finish up in that chapter, and we're telling people that if you're fortunate enough to be reading this before something has actually happened, there's much more that you can and should do and learn and acquire. And we're telling people, you know, the MREs and the freeze-dried and the buckets of beans, right? You know, we're telling them, you know, go get this stuff if you're reading this beforehand, because it'll be cheaper, it'll last longer, et cetera. The same with our radiation detection equipment. I mean, you know, you're not going to be able to buy it once something's happened. If we're not sold out, the phone lines will be down, or your credit card won't work or something, you know, or UPS isn't delivering, or it wouldn't get to you in time if they did. So, you know, we're looking at it at different stages, whether it's imminent or whether you're looking at doing it beforehand. Getting to the shelter, ideally, if you have a basement, it makes it easier. You pick a corner, you shove a table into it, or you make a table out of interior doors that you took off their hinges upstairs, and you lay them across, you know, anything, sawhorses or whatever, and reinforce it, and you pile up heavy stuff all atop it and around it. We have pictures of that in my chapter in the Frightening Issues book. And what we're doing is we're going to hunker down under there, and the fallout's going to be on the ground, and it's going to be on the roof. And if you're in a basement, 90% of the radiation that you're going to have to deal with is coming through the roof, because you're below ground level. And so we're piling stuff up on top of our table, our impromptu shelter that we stuck in a corner of the basement. And that's what we're going to hunker under. This mass, anything heavy is mass, and all this heavy stuff you pile up on it, whether it's books or water containers or your food containers or cordwood or, you know, anything that you have that has weight, this heavy stuff absorbs the radiation. Now, the fallout is a particulate dust matter. It's sitting on your roof, and it's radiating X-ray-type gamma rays through the house. It's like your whole roof is an X-ray machine. And when you get under all of this heavy stuff, it's being absorbed by the radiation is being absorbed into this material. It's just like a policeman with body armor, that the energy of the bullet is absorbed into that material. And that's what all of this heavy stuff is doing. If you don't have a basement in the center of your home, you can go ahead and do the same thing. You're just going to have to use more mass on all four sides to accomplish the same level of shielding. And it makes a world of difference, that distance from the fallout that's outside in your family that's inside, and piling all that heavy stuff up around you makes a huge difference in absorbing that radiation. And remember, with every passing hour, the radioactivity is weakening. So you know, even if it's 500 Rentkin to start with, it's, you know, in 7 hours, 90% of that lethal intensity is already gone. So anything you can do to pile mass around you and increase the distance from the fallout, that, you know, it's going to be outside everywhere snow would land or fall, you know, you are further protecting yourself.
Shane, it's Joe again. We're getting some questions from the chat room here. Got a guy that would like to know what your feelings about potassium iodide are. And what kind of quantities would a family of generally 3 to 5 want to keep on hand, what the doses might be like, and how much they'd need to carry on for a couple of weeks? Would they need enough to go on for 30 days, 1 week, couple of days? And also, would iodized salt work in a pinch?
We cover all of those questions on our KI4U.com website. Iodized salt is in such a small quantity in the salt that to get the same amount of potassium iodide via salt, iodized salt, that you would get out of one dose of KI you know, a potassium iodide tablet, you'd have to take 5 cups of that iodized salt a day. That'll kill you. Okay? So the iodized salt in your salt is good for general nutritional means, but it will not give you a thyroid-blocking dose of iodine like potassium iodide tablets would give you. And also, a lot of people won't have, they won't have found out that they needed to get potassium iodide in time. And we also have in that chapter, we also show how you can go ahead and actually paint tincture of iodine or betadine iodine on your skin, on your abdomen or your forearm, and we give the formula for how much, for how, you know, adult or 4 different sized children. And your skin will actually absorb a thyroid-blocking dose of iodine safely. And I do need to say here, we're never, never talking about drinking or ingesting tincture of iodine or betadine iodine or any iodine solution. We are not talking about doing that. We're talking about painting it on your skin, applying it topically, and your skin will actually absorb it and give you a blocking dose. It's not as specific a dose as the tablet would be, because people absorb at different rates through their skin and they sweat and, you know, this sort of thing. But we reference the studies that show where they've tested this, and it really will make a heck of a difference for a lot of people. And you can buy that at the local pharmacy right now.
Mm-hmm. What about another question from the chat room? Is it necessary to take potassium iodine if you're over 40? And then a second question past that, what if you're allergic to iodine?
Okay. If you're allergic to iodine, you should not take any iodine product. Most people that are allergic to iodine, they know who they are, and they need to not take it. They risk anaphylactic shock, and we don't want to go that route. What was the first part of the question?
Oh, if they're over 40.
Oh, yeah.
Is there any difference between?
Yeah, no, that's a very good question. What we found is that as you get much over the age of 40, the odds of the thyroid cancer ever fully expressing itself in your remaining lifetime begins to drop off, okay? And it's just the opposite the younger you get. The ones that are most vulnerable are the baby in the womb and young children, because of the developmental stages they're going through. They can see ravaging, deathly thyroid cancer within a year. I mean, it's a very, very big problem. And thyroid cancer is not just a, well, if I get cancer, I'll get it removed type thing. We have about 1,000 people every year in the U.S. die of thyroid cancer. And a lot of that, by the way, and we show this on our website, has been traced back to our atomic nuclear test back in the 50s. I mean, we got this from, you know, I forget which cancer society is, but it's an acclaimed cancer source that shows it by county on our website, the amount of radioactive iodine across the whole United States, and they've traced a lot of the thyroid cancers that people have gotten in later years. They trace it back to those atomic tests. So it's serious stuff. Mm-hmm. But anyways, over the age of 40, you know, if you're in short supply and you got children, you know, it's pregnant women and children first. If you're in short supply, and as you get much over the age of 40, the odds start to drop off. You could still have problems in later life, but the odds begin to drop off over the age of 40.
Shane, I'd like to ask what the shelf life for the iodine that you would take, and the ThyroSafe that you have on your website would be. What's the normal life shelf life, and if it expires, should we be concerned?
Our current product right now, says on our website, I have to go take a look at it, but I think it's 5 or 6 years out. And we have very fresh supplies here because we sell so much of it. I mean, we've got new product coming in every 3 months. Now, here's a neat thing about it. If you keep it dry and you don't expose it to high heat, keep it at room temperature or less, Your potassium iodide tablets should be good for another 6 to 8 years beyond expiration date. And we have this from actual government tests that we have on the KI4U.com website, where we show the government having tested it and found it out. Remember, potassium iodide, if you look at your iodized salt container when we get done here, you're going to see that one of the ingredients that makes it iodized, the reason that makes it iodized, is potassium iodide, the exact same stuff that's in the tablet. And like salt, if you keep it dry and you don't try to melt it, it'll be good darn near forever.
Well, can I jump backwards a smidgen and talk a little bit about radiation? You were talking how that it diminishes pretty quickly.
Right.
The lethalism. Can you tell me how we can tell when the radiation is actually gone? I noticed that in your chapter, you had a Geiger counter as part of your shelter item that you should have.
If you don't have radiation detection equipment, you're going to be at the mercy of that your radio still works and that the government is broadcasting to tell you when it's safe in your local area. And, you know, that has a lot of failure points in it.
Right.
Because they may be talking to the whole state. They may not know what's going on in your own neighborhood.
Right.
And
exactly.
any area downwind could have a higher concentration of radiation from what's called a rainout. And there was a test done, I think it was, I don't want to say the date because I get it wrong, but it's late 1950s. There was a test done over there in Nevada, and a day later, or a day and a half later, they had very high radiation levels in downstate New York, New York State. And there's a university down there that's recording these wild radiation levels. And they couldn't figure out, you know, if we've been attacked or what happened. And the professor there was able to go ahead and ascertain that this test had been done. They had a very high thunderstorm right there when the fallout in the upper atmosphere was going through. This was like a 40,000-foot high thunderstorm. It washed the fallout out of the sky, and it concentrated it in downstate New York down by the Hudson, and just flipped them out. That they had all this radiation over there. It, fortunately, the rain continued on and washed it further. You know, it washed it into the rivers and stuff. But it was pretty amazing. So when the government goes to telling you what's going on, if they don't have somebody that's right in your immediate area telling you, you know, you may come out of your shelter too early, or you may stay in there much longer than you needed to. And that's why we do have radiation equipment. Available so you can tell right where you are that it's safe or not safe. And if the government tells you to evacuate, if they tell you, hey, everybody north of the interstate, you head this way, you know, and everybody south, go this way. If you're with that exodus and you've got a nuke alert or some small handheld detector, you're going to be able to confirm that they're not telling you wrong, or that the wind hasn't changed or something else, and you'll be able to confirm that you got yourself to a safe place.
You know, you actually are, I think, the manufacturer for Nuke Alert, which is a really, really well-known handheld device that people can get. You also did have, or maybe still do have, Geiger counter equipment. I mean, you at one time, you had the largest non-governmental supply of, like, recalibrated Geiger counters in the nation, and I know your lab is licensed to recalibrate these Geiger counters when they are decommissioned from the military. Do you still have a lot of that equipment?
We do. And what we did was 8 months prior to 9/11, we bought out of the Federal Depot from FEMA in Fort Worth 416 pallet loads of survey meters, Geiger counters, and
altimeters.
This was all the civil defense equipment. If we hadn't won that and gotten a hold of that, it was headed to a landfill. I mean, that was the Clinton administration. So we got all that stuff and brought it down here to our lab. At the time that we set up the lab, I didn't have the credentials to run this. I mean, this is a NRC-certified and Texas, you know, Bureau of Radiation Control lab. But I hired a guy that did, and he's been in the business since the early 60s, and he's worked at all the national labs, and he's even he had even calibrated these same type civil defense instruments. So we have the largest private supply in the country, and we are the only private lab in the country that specializes in recalibrating and recertifying all of those yellow survey meters and dosimeters and Geiger counters, which are still in use by literally hundreds of municipalities and fire departments across the country.
Well, those things are great, and they're commercial made, the military made. I mean, they used our tax dollars, which means that, you know, if a hammer normally costs $40, get it through the government, it costs $400 or $500. So they can put the money into making the best equipment on earth.
Yeah, now most of the stuff is 40 years old, but it's been tested by time, and it's also very EMP proof. In fact, the first ones that they made them out of plastic, and then they threw those out, and they started making them out of metal, and they even changed the meters. The holder for the meter glass was plastic, and they changed that to metal too. And we're talking about older technology that doesn't have all of the semiconductors and fragile parts to it, and most of them just use regular D-cell batteries. So I mean, it's nothing exotic there. So they're still in use. You know, I want to say by over 1,000 departments, but it's in the high hundreds that are still using them. And you know, the first Bush administration started defunding the radiological portion of FEMA. Every state in the union had these for every county and every city, and every state in the union had a lab. You know, with these cesium calibrators that were made for these instruments, they had either one or two of these calibrators, and the Clinton administration totally defunded it and had everybody send everything back in, and there's only like five states that kept calibrating them on their own for their own use.
Hey, it's Joe Artis. We're back from the break. And I want to ask you another question from the chat room, Shane.
Alrighty.
We kind of went over this a little bit earlier, and wanted to follow up with a second part of a question we'd kind of touched on. Potassium iodide, not to totally misdirect the conversation, but to bring closure to one of the questions here in the chat room. We talked about there being people that might be allergic to taking potassium iodide. Would there be an alternative other than just really good shelter for somebody that is allergic to something like that?
3M makes a gas mask that has a filter specifically for radioiodine. I can't give you any prices or anything on it, but you might go ahead and look into that. I should also mention there was, I don't know, 8 million doses I'm probably got the number wrong, but multiple millions of doses given out during Chernobyl. And people that were even allergic to iodine did take it without ill effect. But I'm not recommending that. What I suggest everyone do is that now, before there's an emergency, if you get potassium iodide and you have it stored, talk to your doctor and make sure that there's no reason anyone in your family should not use it. There are some other kidney ailments, some other skin diseases that are contraindicated, some potassium-sparing diuretics and different drugs that are contraindicated. In other words, you should not take potassium iodide if you're on these medications. Now, before there's any emergency, and you can simply call up your doctor, tell them, hey, I got some of these potassium iodide tablets. Is there any reason why anybody in my family shouldn't take them? And another interesting footnote is, if you're going to have an allergic reaction to iodine by taking the tablet, you're also going to have the same allergic reaction if you inhale radioactive iodine. So you're still fighting the same allergy, you know. So that's why some people in Chernobyl that were allergic to iodine did go ahead and take the radioactive iodine without ill effect. But I'm strongly recommending, I'm not a doctor, I can't advise you, and I'm not here, Talk to your doctor, especially if you have any thyroid condition or any concern in that regard. Talk to your doctor. Make sure that it'd be okay for you and everyone in your family that you're responsible for to take it if you had to in a future nuclear emergency. Okay?
Well, Shane, for our friends who have maybe just tuned in or have jumped into our chat room here, can I recap on a couple of little things? One is you've talked about sheltering, and we've covered quite a bit of that, and I know there's a lot of information on your website. But one issue that you skimmed and we didn't get a chance to talk about was pets. How do we handle our pets? Do we give them ThyroSafe iodine tablets, or and if we do, what do we look for in our pets as a form of danger or infection?
Cats and dogs both can be given potassium iodide as well. I don't have the numbers right in front of me as far as the dosage, but when you take a look at the dosage for young children and babies and the weights involved, it's going to match up the same for the pets. In other words, it's done by weight, so you can figure it out that it's going to be a small, infant size dose for a cat, and for a small child, for a medium-sized dog, et cetera. So you can figure the dosing that way, and it would be safe to give it to them. Regarding pets, though, in a nuclear disaster, if you haven't made provision for them, food-wise and everything else, the disruptions could go on quite a while. And I really want to discourage people from thinking they're being humane to let their pets run free. Packs of dogs and the radiation that they would suffer and the danger they are to other humans running in packs is going to be something you don't want to have contributed to. So if you can't take care of your pet right, you might have the unpleasant task of having to put the dog down than to have them running, letting them loose to run with a pack. So you got to prepare for them too.
That goes for cats too, I would assume.
Yeah, I was kind of trying to figure out cat packs and what they they might be like.
Most people contain their dogs a little more than cats. Cats roam free, unleashed more so than dogs do, I think.
Yeah, and we don't want to have them out there, if we have levels of radioactivity, because they're going to suffer miserably for anything.
No, I don't agree with you.
One of the things you mentioned earlier, though, that I had never thought of that's very interesting is, during an event like this, I probably would not have to concern myself about getting attacked by a pack of wild cats. But a bunch of wild dogs, and especially if they're hungry and they're savaging for food, I mean, even domesticated dogs at some point might become feral, right?
No, they do. They'll go back to the wild. You'll have an alpha dog and a sub-alpha dog. And it could be the smallest beagle in the pack, and all the other ones are big, but he's got the attitude. And I'll tell you, you don't want to get caught out with them circling around you, because you're dinner. Once they've tasted it, it's a horrendous, horrendous thing, and a lot of people are going to be letting dogs loose. People just don't understand how bad that could be, for having survived everything. And then having to deal with that, where you can't go out the back door to work your garden or anything else,
Well, now, you mentioned a minute ago that after the event, that is a nuclear explosion, that extended types of disruptions people should be prepared for. You didn't mention what types of disruptions you're talking about that we haven't already discussed. Are there other things? I mean, are you talking about looting or something else?
No, looting will be part of it, and we have to be careful when we look back in history, like at the Depression, and we see how people pulled together and did what was necessary. And people today, by and large, they're just not made of the self-reliant moral character of our grandparents' generation. I'm saying overall, the morality that sustained them and restrained them back then is not as prevalent today, and we have a large class of people that they have a mentality of government should take care of them and all this sort of thing, and we saw some of that down in Katrina. Mm-hmm. And you've got a huge class of people that, you know, were our grandparents, many of them, they knew how to make do on less, and they were closer to the land. If they didn't farm, they bought their food locally, and they had chickens and back. And so most people are so far removed from their source of food that you know, they just don't have a clue. And they're, people will revert and rationalize, as you mentioned earlier, very quickly to, you know, burglary and thievery and looting and rioting, you know, when they get hungry and stuff, you know.
Well, that's the kind of disruptions you're talking about, or were you talking about maybe things that are more technological? How will people be able to communicate? I wanted to follow up with that question.
Yeah, no, listen, all of your services, you know, your electricity and your fuel and banking and medical services and you know, the food supplies, you know, the deliveries to the stores and stuff. I mean, look at the extended misery that hurricane victims in Florida have gone through, even with the rest of the country able to help them out. I mean, they're down there without electricities and phone and all this stuff. I mean, some of them for months. And if we had nuclear stuff go off in multiple cities here, I mean, you may be on your own for, I don't know, could be years in some areas if it was wide enough, you know. So your law enforcement, I mean, what's left of them, they've been overrun by, you know, by everybody, you know, that's acting crazy, or they're home protecting their own families, and it's going to be a very dark time, and there's no telling how long that will go on. Now, we cover that in that chapter. I mean, we talk about that in making those preparations. It's very overwhelming when you first look at it, but we show people how to do it in twos. In other words, put together everything you'd need for 2 weeks if all services to your home were cut off. And I'm talking, you know, in any season, you know, heating, cooling, electric, phone, you know, in other words, you had to stay home. Do what you need to do so that you could do that for 2 weeks. It'd be like an extended camping trip. And once you've accomplished that, then add additional provisions and supplies so that you could go ahead and maintain that for 2 months. And then continue to add months to that. And when you look at this, what's really neat about it is that even if nothing nuclear happened, it may serve you well if we had a pandemic and you have to self-quarantine yourself at home. Or
that's
it may be
that's a good thought.
Yeah, and it may be as simple as you lost your job. And wouldn't it be wonderful to at least not have to worry about food for 3 or 4
right.
months while you go looking for another one?
You know what's interesting is you're saying 2 weeks and then build on that, but start with 2 weeks and build on that. And I keep hearing this 72-hour thing from the Department of Homeland Security, FEMA, and we have said forever and held forever at Raiders, Survivor Mall, and everywhere else, that 72 hours has been historically illustrated to simply not be long enough. I mean, even a week to us is the bare minimum. 2 weeks is much better. And now I'm hearing you say the same thing. What do you think? Is this a weakness? Why are they communicating the 72-hour thing to everybody?
Well, you know, it might be the panic thing. You know, some of them, some of the different agencies and the Red Cross and stuff, some of them have started to inch out to 2 weeks from the 72-hour thing. You know, but when you're talking nuclear with them, They just figure, you know, there's nothing you can do for anybody. You know, I mean, they're of that same mindset that you can't really prepare for anything nuclear. It's a game buster, you know. So, I mean, that's part of the attitude right there. We talk about it in the chapter in Frightening Issues, and we actually talk about adding 2 months, 2 months, 2 months until you get all the way out to a year. And again, we hope that that's great overkill. But if it happens, you are going to want to help friends, neighbors, and relatives. And so whatever you can do, you won't have too much. And another neat thing is when you're buying in bulk and you're using foods, you know, raw foods, you know, like the pails of food, you're buying very cheaply. You're actually saving money. Uh-huh. So, and a footnote to all of the survival food, too, is besides rotating it, you have to get it into your diet on a semi-regular basis, because when we have a crisis, that is not the time to change everybody's diet. Their stomach is already going to be upset because of the crisis, and you sure don't want to be shifting everybody over to wheat products right then. You know, it needs to be a regular part, at least on a weekly basis. You use some of this stuff so you're familiar with preparing it, and people are in your family are used to eating it. We don't want to shock everybody, when a crisis happens. That's the worst time to make a diet change.
Shane, Joe here again. When a person is sheltering in place, you know, Hollywood, a lot of times you watch these movies and you'll see these films where it's like post the apocalypse and
right. There's
radiation everywhere, and this is decades later. And then talking with you tonight, it sounds that the majority of the fallout happens within the first several hours. But when a person is, just to de-Hollywood the question, realistically, when a person is sheltering in place, how long does the oxygen where they're sheltering hold up? Let's say I'm inside of a basement, and I've taken a table, and I've padded everything that I have that's dense around it, and I'm hiding inside. How long does the oxygen hold up? I saw not even a week ago an advertisement where there's a company that actually builds underground storm shelters for people to have put in for them. And I, again, looked at it and thought, if you're down inside one of those below the surface of the earth, how long does the oxygen hold up?
Yeah, you've got to be able to bring fresh air in, and we address that in the book where we're actually creating two air spaces, one high and one low, at opposite ends of the basement shelter or the upstairs shelter, so that we can bring air in, and the naturally warming convection air will help it go out the other end. And we'll fan it with a piece of cardboard or something if we have to. We're using the air that's in the basement, and if it gets stale, we also talk in that chapter about how you can put a common HEPA furnace filter on a window and bring in fresher air into that basement, or open a door that leads upstairs so you're bringing some air from upstairs. And again, what we're dealing with the radioactive fallout is it's a particulate matter. It's like dust. And a common HEPA filter will keep the bulk of it out of there, so that you can bring fresh air in. You're quite correct, though. We don't take this shelter and make it airtight. We want the air from the basement to go in. The shelter is simply masked to keep the gamma rays that are outside from penetrating into where you're sitting inside.
You referred to the book that you had. Is the book that you're referring to How to Overcome the Most Frightening Issues? Is that the book you were referring to?
Yes, it is.
For?
Okay. Yeah, I meant to make that clear. Yeah.
That's okay. I just wanted to know, because we've talked so much about information on your website, I want to know where I'm going to find this information.
Well, the bulk, I'll tell you, the bulk of our information that's front and center on our website, I fine-tuned and updated that for the Frightening Issues book. I mean, my chapter in there is the best of the best stuff that I have on my 600 pages of website material. So that is, you know, people ought to get a copy of the book.
Well, I must confess, I did peruse your chapter quite clearly today, and it was very excellent. In fact, it got me very excited about some of the things we've talked about, not only just making sure our own family is prepared, but community too. But I wanted to ask another question.
Sure.
I had it written down, and it's here somewhere.
Well, while she's go ahead.
Seasonal. You know how you get concepts in your head about every disaster happens during the summer or whenever it's daylight.
Right,
you know,
right.
What can we do? What would you recommend, or where can we find information? Do you have information on your website about disasters or nuclear destruction during dark time hours or in the winter, things that are like even double scary?
Well, we do address in the chapter, in the Frightening Issues, what we're going to be, let me see how I put it in there. We do talk about, as you do the twos, that first 2 weeks that you're putting it together, it's like setting up to do an extended camping trip for 2 weeks in any season of the year. So summer or winter, clothing-wise, whatever it is you would need. We're wanting people to not make that false assumption that it'll be a summertime camp out. So we're trying to address that a little bit. As far as the things happening in the evening, if a nuke went off in the evening and it's nighttime and you're sleeping, that's where some of our detection equipment would come in. But what I'm anticipating is that not a surprise attack, but a ramp up of things going on in the world that have you alert that something could happen at any time. And you need to have in your group of people that you're working with, somebody needs to be up and watching what's going on almost 24 hours a day, or you need to be on a call list or other people in your area that you're working with, so that you know somebody can give a heads up to the whole group. And that's one of the things where I talk about having a buffer of like-minded people surrounding you that you're working with, because you just can't stand guard on this stuff by yourself for 24 hours a day. You've got to have other people that you're working with.
And I assume that you also mean contacting immediate family and extended family, a plan for that.
And it's pre-planned for where people are going to go or meet
exactly.
up if you can't communicate.
Exactly.
So, if the phones go down and the electricity's off and you can't see that it was from an ice storm that brought the power lines down or something,
right.
We're all going to do this until we find out better. And in fact, we tell people in regards to taking the potassium iodide, if there's a big explosion upwind of you and you don't know yet whether it was nuclear or not,
mm-hmm.
what we tell people to do is take your first dose of potassium iodide. You're covered now for the next 24 hours in regards to that threat while you sort out whether it was nuclear or not. And if it turns out not to be nuclear, you simply discontinue taking any more. You've done no harm.
Right, that's good information.
Can you take too much potassium iodide?
Yeah, you could take too much. You're going to get a metallic taste in your mouth at first. You also don't take potassium iodide in the doses, the 130 milligram doses for thyroid blocking. You would never take it daily like you do a nutritional supplement or a vitamin. It's an overload on your thyroid gland to do that, and it would be harmful. You're only going to be taking it for about 10 days, and then the radioactive iodine is pretty well lost all of its punch, and you would simply discontinue taking it after that time. For a single event, if another event happened, you start the clock again.
All right. So far tonight we've been talking about what to do if there is a nuclear disaster or if a nuclear disaster is imminent. We've talked about taking effective protective action. Do you stay or go in your home, in your community, in your place? If you're going to go, what do you take with you? What are the kind of things that you should do to prepare? And this also includes food, pertinent food and supplies, not just potassium iodide, but food and supplies. We've also talked about water. We've talked about shelter that you want to create, whether, like you said, whether it's firewood or whatever it is, you want to create as much of a shield between yourself and the nuclear fallout as you can. We're going to spend the next 2 or 3 minutes before we hit the end of the show talking about various other kinds of essential details. I want to ask you really quick, if people, let's say people have water, they've set aside X amount of water for 2 weeks, but for whatever reason, they get stuck in a situation like some of the people in New Orleans were, where they were down there until finally the mayor, the governor, or the mayor, I guess it was, he's out there on the street cussing, wanting to know where's the government, because pretty soon people are surrounded by all kinds of water, but the water's contaminated, they can't drink it. Are there particular kinds of ways that you address on how you can use nature's water? How do you get nature's water? If you run out of water, how do you get water from nature, and how do you purify it? Do you deal with those kind of things?
Not too much. I mean, we talk about getting water filters beforehand is what you're going to need to do, and there's some great water filters out there that'll take the muddiest water and make it clean again. We do talk about bleach and the amount to use. We also talk about boiling water as well. However, for stored water for the shelter use and immediately afterwards, if you took it out of the tap, that water should be fine, you know, for the duration of the event. But we make a very heavy, heavy emphasis that you cannot store too much water. So that
cats do, because thing is, you can live quite a long time actually without food or with very little food, but you can't live very long without water.
No, you can't. Now, and I had a experience out in the Gulf of Mexico here about a month ago, and I ran out of wind and my engine went out too. And I was out there 12 hours. It wasn't strenuous, but it was hot and humid. And I drank literally 4 gallons of water.
Mm-hmm.
And it just sweated out. I never went to the bathroom that whole 12 hours.
Well, you know what's interesting, Shane, is
four,
I grew up in
4 gallons. I mean, it's just
I grew up in the Arizona desert, and we were surrounded by water. Every year, we'd be amazed at the number of people that were found whose car had broke down. And they were found dead, dehydrated, died of heat exhaustion or whatever in the Arizona desert. And here there's barrel cactus and stuff all around them. You can also take just a little simple piece of plastic and make an upside-down pyramid, draw water out of the ground. But it's knowing how to get it. Well, these are some of the very basic things that we're talking about here, how to get water, boil it for 10 minutes, or use an eyedropper. Like you said, use liquid chlorine bleach for 16 drops if the water's cloudy. Wait 30 minutes, then you can drink it. You can also use iodine if you know how to do it.
Right.
So that's some of the basic things that we're talking about here. I want to ask you, we're going to run out of time real fast, I know. I want to ask you another kind of off the path question here. Did you ever watch the television series Jericho?
Oh, yeah. What a missed opportunity to have educated people correctly.
Yeah,
what
you know, I could not get. I mean, it was at the time ABC or NBC. I can't remember. It was their number one show, and when they canceled it, I thought, "What? I mean, isn't this all about commercial advertising? Why do you take the number one show and cancel it?" But anyway, but the scenario there, community against community, at some point for control of basic services and supplies, is that? Do you think that kind of speculative scenario is that feasible at all? I mean, honestly, could we see a scenario in the United States where you have a staged event, nuclear explosions in various cities, all of a sudden people are cut off from all kinds of communication, and also if you have an electromagnetic pulse weapon, it closes down all of your electronic devices, people are having a hard time communicating, they go back to using, you know, the old radio headsets and their Morse code and whatever. I mean, could we really see that kind of a situation? Is that possible?
Well, I think we'll still have the powers to be, and after the people have been suffering long and hard enough from it to where they'll eagerly accept anything, then you're going to have the draconian solutions offered, by the powers to be. And
now, draconian solutions, are you talking about something that almost sounds like biblical prophecy here?
Well, I'm talking full-blown dictatorship. I mean, you're going to lose the last, you're going to have eroded away the last of your remaining wealth and freedoms. And in other words, that they're going to use that opportunity to go ahead and usher in, the destruction of our Constitution and everything we take for granted.
Yeah. All right. Well,
on that happy note.
Yeah. No. I mean, you know, one of the things we have not done here tonight and that we usually do at Raiders News Network is that we also include the possibly prophetic. And when you start talking about the implementation of martial law, I know that you're dealing with this stuff with more of a straight-up survivalist kind of thing and very good information. But, I mean, do you personally, I can't say off the record because you're on the radio, but do you have any feelings about any of that, or should we maybe not go there?
Well, I believe that prepared people will not be so easily stampeded and herded into the agenda of what some very evil people would like to have you know, New World Order and the whole
Amen.
Thing go down.
Mm-hmm.
So
the address
prepared people won't be. And how much time do we have left?
I think we've only got a couple of minutes, 2 minutes.
Okay. I just wanted to say that good and moral people are historically they're at a disadvantage because they can't begin to imagine how evil people are. In other words, they have no personal experience with that extreme lust for power and arrogance that possesses the Hitler-type, Stalin-Mao-type people. And if the previous generation could have those kind of people rise up, I'm very concerned about the current population in the world because we're so far removed from, you know, what was a higher moral standard of the last generation.
I agree with you entirely.
You know, these people are, you know, these wannabe Hitlerite people are walking amongst us today.
Are we having them in our nation?
Absolutely.
Do we have them at the executive level?
Absolutely.
Listen to me like you've never listened to me, ever in your life. We have got to lay our lives down for the purposes of God. This is not a Sunday school picnic, the Church of Jesus Christ. This is not an invitation to have continuous good times. This is a war for the souls of men. Come out from among them. Run for your life. Because this is about your life. It's not just about an opposing theology, a conflicting viewpoint on Jesus. This is about your life. My mind is forever branded with the story that I heard of police officers from the city of New York. As people were fleeing from a crumbling building, there were police officers and firemen and others that were running towards the building saying, run for your life at their own peril. And in some cases, I believe they knew they were going to die, but there was a sense of duty. I was crying out to God. I said, God, oh Jesus, don't let my sense of duty be less for your kingdom than these beloved firemen and policemen were for those that are perishing in the fallen tower. We're living in a generation when truth is falling into the streets. I want to be among those that are not running away from the conflict, but running into the conflict and say, run for your life! Run from gospels that focus only on success and prosperity. Run! Run from those who use the name of Christ only for his personal gain. Run from those that are picking your pocket in the name of Jesus. Run! Run from gospels that only focus on self-improvement. Run! Run from churches where men and not Christ are glorified. Run! Run! Body of Christ, run! Get out! Don't touch the unclean thing! Run from churches in America and Canada where there is no Bible. There's no cross in the theology. There's no soul-searching word. There's no repentance from sin. There's no mention of the blood of Jesus. Run! It's unclean! Run! Run from churches where you're comfortable in your sins. If you come into the house of God and you've got sin in your life and you're not convicted of it, you're at a table of devils. Run from pulpits that are filled with political men who are using the pulpit of God for a personal political agenda. Run! Run from those who preach division between races and cultures. Run! Run! Get out! Turn it off! Get away from it! They know nothing of God! Run from ungodly, spasmodic movement and endless, empty prophesying. Beloved church, run for your life. Run from preachers that stand and tell stories and jokes. Run like you've never run before. Run! Run! Run!
So when we last left off, we went through a compound and we had some battles with some mercenaries. And I'm hearing some noises behind the store, so I know there's a bad guy behind there. See if you can see him. He's got like a watchdog or something there. I'm trying to open the door without getting my head blown off. See if we could throw a grenade in there. Well, this is why you want to act a little bit faster. And of course the grenade blows me up. So let's start again. Okay, so we're back at the door. So this time what we'll do is I'll open it and then
get out of here, you bastard, or I'll take you all out.
Darn it. Come on, door, open up. We'll throw a couple of grenades in there. Dang it, he's shooting me again. Now, how could he be alive after all that? But check out the atmosphere before we go in there. Pretty cool, huh? Oh, let's get back to it. I'm going to use a shotgun. I hear him reloading in there. How could he still be alive? Well, if he is alive, he's injured pretty much. He's right there, I think. Ah! My gun jammed right at that moment. My luck. That's another thing too, is the weapons get real old and you have to repair them and stuff. Okay, I'm bleeding out, hold on. I have this rifle in full auto, so. Is he? Forgot I had a silencer on this. How many times do I gotta shoot this guy? Oh, you're going through all my ammo here. I'll use the pistol ammo since that's cheaper. Finally. Alright guys, there's a something hidden down here. And so we can use this device right here. It's like a little metal detector type device. It'll find, it'll basically guide us to whatever's hidden down here. If it starts beeping, then that means we're getting close. So here we go. All right, we got something. But those fire things right there, they really can mess you up, so we gotta walk cautiously. Found it.
Choker's a piece of work, too. Gets pissed off, grabs his bag, and disappears. While I was trying to calm Carton down, he left in hell if I know where he went. And what am I supposed to do?
How the heck?
Drink
I made it out.
Moron? No, thank you. Ew. And to think how promising things were at the beginning.
Ah, we made it out. Let's do a game save. Look around, see if there's any... anything we can pick up. Yeah, let's take a look where we're going here. Right here. Maps. Offer the maps to the pilot. Alright, cool. Starting to rain. Bad news. Almost there.
Put your weapon away, man. Hey, bro.
Going the right way. Right here where these campfires at. With the light off, dang it, you can't even see anything.
Им что, им хорошо. Сидят себе с мобилами, командуют.
Тихо, тихо, значит так.
Let me in on the joke. Alright, so let's see where we're going here.
Надо бы того пидорка гнойного приложить получше, чтоб лишнего потом не вякнуть. И там ли народу вокруг натуре...
There's a road up here, so we'll take this road. This ranger station. Later on you get like night vision, so that'll be helpful. Doesn't open. Nothing here, we'll move along. All right, there's a road going this way, we'll take.
запасных цены... Ёлки, да если подумать, тут выгоднее картошку на продажу сажать, чем хабар собирать. Старой сторожки сидит кровосос. Тут из дома выбегает маленький кровососик и к папе тормошит его. Пап, покажи сталкера. Тот зашел в сторожку, выходит, на каждой руке по черепу. И начинает, как с кухонным тяжким, делать череп так тонко.
Speak to the boss.
Dogs. Using up all my ammo. Let's see if we can get to a road, which would be straight across here.
that shooter away, and then we'll talk. Speak to the big bad boss. Holster that shoulder or get lost.
Thank you. Just relax and keep moving. See, your suit can handle it. Keep going. Help me, stalker! Get out of here while you can.
Stupid weapon. I gotta get that fixed. I really gotta get this weapon fixed. That's one of those zombie guys. I don't think I need to waste this ammo. Drop this. going full auto on this weapon, but this one's pretty old and jammed. I gotta fix it. I had a shotgun, that's what made it pretty tough when it hit me. Oh no, he didn't. Look at it, you shoot them and they get back up. Huh? Switch weapons. Man, that scared the heck out of me. I know this weapon's jammed, but it seems like it's better. tons of them. Oh, let's go with these guys. These are friendlies.
Quit screwing around. Holster your weapon. I'm listening.
Helping me now. Oh, I hate those things. Well, let's mix it up with them anyways. Ready? Maybe we shouldn't have done that. Oh, great. Let's get rid of this gun. All these guns are horrible.
Talk to the boss if you need something. The boss is over there. Go talk to him. Hey, bro.
Oh, these are those zombie dudes. Let's put it back on a single fire. I don't like keeping my back turned for long. I hear lots of them walking. I better heal. this ammo. That thing. There's a shotgun. No, I'm missing the shotgun again. Maybe I didn't pick it up. I did. I just had a grenade. To heal myself, didn't do anything. I don't know if I have to shoot them or if they're just harmless, but tried to bite me, so I think we answer the harmless question. My health's really... I better save this shotgun for some other type of critters.